Hi everyone, this is Sue Reynolds and we are about to begin our webinar for Redesigning School Counseling, and the topic of this webinar is goals. So I want to check the technology real quickly. So just look here, see, let's go to Natalie Hornsby. Natalie, I'm going to unmute you on my end and see, can you hear me okay? Natalie? Well, Natalie, if you're there and you can hear me, if you want to just type into the control panel that yes, you can hear me, I'm going to try someone else as well. I have a feeling you don't have a mic on your computer, so we can't hear you. Okay, let's try Amy Hedrick. Amy, can you hear me, Amy? We may be in the same situation with Amy. Let me see if we can go to chat. Let me make sure that. Looks like I'm on the air. Okay. Oops. I've got Natalie. Natalie says, yes, you can hear us. Okay, good. Thank you, Natalie. And you can see the screen okay, too? You can just type that in. You're seeing a cover screen blue that says goals as the topic. Yes, you can see that, too. Beautiful. Okay. Good. We have a lot to do today, so I am going to go ahead and get started. Our topic today is goals. I'm going to assume we met with another group on Monday of schools that are going through RSC, and we had a chance to talk with them about their council meetings that they had with visioning, and they kind of told us that everything went fine. Their participation was the same as their first meeting. They did not get bogged down in the discussion about the 100% of kids being successful or whatever that. They all had a pretty easy time actually of getting to 100%. So I'm going to assume that you guys are in the same boat. And we're just going to go on to goals. There actually is a lot to cover today, and I just need to kind of get right into it. So, and then as always, if there's a question, I'm going to monitor the question screen as we go. So if you have a question, type it in and we'll answer your questions as we go as well. So yeah, so there's the control panel. We've talked about that before. There's where you type in your questions in that question box. So good. And then the other thing you can do, if you want me to pause as well, you can raise your hand. There's that option as well. Yeah, so good. Okay, couple of updates. One thing that came up since we've talked to you last, I just wanted to make sure that you are all aware that it's real possible to develop your work in a Word doc and then cut and paste it into our system. So some folks were like retyping everything in their vision statement into our system, and all of a sudden the light bulb went off. Oh, we could just cut and paste right from the Word doc where we were developing this. So yes, you can just cut and paste into our system. And then the other thing we wanted to chat about quickly was we've had a lot of questions. A lot of schools have talked to us about there being snow days and they're really having a hard time with serving 95% of the students. So we wanted to talk about that a little bit. We would really like to encourage you to survey 95% for a couple of reasons. One is that when you get into discussions with your council, the council is going to have a lot more faith in the data if they know that all the students surveyed. And then the other reason is that when we start to cut down on the student number, sometimes we get certain student groups that have so few students in them that for confidentiality reasons, we don't report the data back out to you. For example, if instead of surveying all of your sixth graders, you decide to survey only 30 of them, well, that's fine for looking at all the sixth grade, but if you don't end up with at least 10 free and reduced lunch students in that group of 30, then we're not able to provide you with free and reduced lunch student data. So the more students you can survey, the better. We'd really like it to be 95, 100%. But we also understand with that, with all the snow days, that you may not be able to get there. The minimum that we would like you to survey is 30 per grade level. So if you can't do 95, that would be the very minimum. If you can do more than that, that would be great. And just keep in mind that if you're not surveying all your survey set, really has to be randomly selected students. It can't be like all the kids in second period English, because it may be that they're in second period English because there was some high level math course that forced them to be into second period English. So just make sure that it's really a random selection. And then also keep in mind that if you may end up not getting data for some student groups, if we don't end up with at least 10 students in the student group in your random selection. So we just wanted to mention that. When Tina is reviewing your work, she may ask you some questions, and we just want to make sure that that's something that you've considered. But if you tell us, you know, we've done our best and we can only get to 50% this year because of all the snow days or whatever, that will be okay. Okay, so mention that. So let's get right into the meeting. In this meeting, we're talking about goals. So we've been out in kind of dreamland to talk about, you know, if all of our dreams came true, what would we want for our kids? You know, what would that picture look like? And now we're coming back to reality and we're saying, okay, let's, you know, we know where we want to go. Now let's look at where we are and let's figure out some goals, some realistic steps to our dream, to our vision. Okay, so there's some meeting prep that we want to do. The first thing is that we're going to send an email or a postal mail to your council members to ask them to do a task before they get to your meeting. This is going to save you a ton of time. So the email says this. It basically says, you know, thank you for being part of our work. And then we give a quick introduction of what a goal is and how we write goals. So this is just an explanation of, in our work, how we express goals and what goals mean. And then we're explaining in the bottom section here that at the next meeting, you're going to review as a group a list of suggested goals that we will give you, and you'll determine if those goals are good goals for your kids, or if you need to add some new goals or take some of those out or whatever. We're providing you a list of suggested goals, again, just to save you time so you're not starting with a blank page, but you've got something to start with. Okay, so the second part of the letter, it says, here's the pre-meeting task. We'd like the schools or your council members to review the third paragraph in the vision statement. That's the paragraph that talks about ideal kids and what, you know, the kinds of behaviors and attitudes that we want in these ideal students. And then we're asking your council members to print a list of the suggested goals. And then to check the goals that they think are good for your students. So, and again, we're just doing this to save time, so we're not starting with a blank piece of paper. After doing this work for 20 years, we in working with a gazillion schools, we kind of have, you know, we know the goals that tend to be common in most schools. So they can go through the list and check them. And then we've given them a couple of really important notes. One is we're telling them that it's okay to check all of the goals if they think that those are choices that all of your students should make. Most people actually will check all the goals, if not, you know, maybe all but one or two or whatever. And that tends to make people nervous. They're thinking, oh, I'm checking every single one. And what we want to tell them is that's okay. And then on the flip side, we also want to tell them if they don't like any of those goals, they don't have to check any of them. They don't think they apply to your students. So again, we're just doing this as a time saver. So then in step four, we're asking them to say, okay, look at all of these choices, all of these goals, and which 3 to 5 do they think that your school should spend a lot of time on next year? And so they're kind of in their own mind prioritizing, you know, which of these choices that we want kids to make, which are the most important. And then the fifth instruction is just to bring that piece of paper with them to the meeting, to your meeting. Okay, so that's the pre-meeting mailing where people are going to be understanding goals and thinking about goals before they even get to you. Okay, then I'm going to come back to the next slide, but there are a lot of tasks to do after the meeting. These, it looks like it's really time consuming, but most of this is just going into the system and making checks and a checklist. So don't freak out. It's not as time consuming as it looks. And I'll run through that at the end of our webinar today. But we just want to give you a heads up that there are some tasks that the steering team is going to need to do afterwards. Okay. So now, this would be a good place to type in a question if you have any. And if not, I'm now going to go and just walk through the meeting with you. So I'll look for questions as I'm switching to a different presentation, goals presentation. Okay, and we'll go up to the first slide. Okay, first of all, there is a lot to cover in this meeting. It's going to be really important that you keep this meeting moving. Because there's just several steps that we need to accomplish. So, okay, so we're welcoming the council. We're telling them, you know, that we're talking about goals this time. And we're giving them a heads up that we've made a lot of progress. And I think it's important that your council understands all the work that you've done already. You know, look at what you have now that you didn't have before you started this work. You have an organizational structure. You've collected data. You're starting with your foundations, you've got your benefit statements are finished, your vision statement is finished, goals is finished, and then you've just got two more steps after this. The goal step is probably the most technical of all this. It's where we bring in data for the first time. We're going to use some consensus building tools. So I think it's also really important today that if there's any of this that is fuzzy to you, that we make sure that we're asking questions today so that when you facilitate this with your council, you're good to go. So please ask questions. Okay, so we're telling the council that here's the things that we're going to do today. First of all, we're going to just do an introduction about what our goals, then we're going to create our program goals, and then we're going to prioritize them. And there's some steps in this prioritization that will help us understand how to prioritize them. So, but basically, there's three parts. We're going to introduce what is a goal and how do we do them in this initiative. We're going to create all of our goals, and then we're going to prioritize them. Okay. So here's the intro, and we're reminding people that the whole mission of this initiative is to help kids make better choices, to make sound choices. And not just randomly thinking about choices, but choices that are connected towards the vision that you just created at your last meeting. So what choices do kids need to make if we're going to move closer to that vision that we created last month? So the other thing that you could kind of give a heads up on or kind of a preview on here is that goals are the student choices. Our student choices will become the goals of our program. It really is the goal of the whole program is to help kids make better choices. So all of our goals are going to be focused on student choices. So, and I guess I got ahead of myself. So the program goal are the choices that we want our students to make in order to move towards our mission and vision. So this middle step here in this pyramid that we've been talking about for 2 months, this middle step, our goals are to help kids make these targeted choices that we want them to make. Okay, and then I've kind of said this already too, but just the idea on this slide is that these student choices, whatever our goals are, they're going to move us closer to the vision that we developed last month. Okay, then here's some examples. So the goals are always worded as it's to increase the percentage of students who, and then the activity or, you know, the action that we want the kids to take. to increase the percentage of students who report bullying, enroll in algebra, identify career clusters. So when I'm presenting this slide to a group, especially a group of non-counselors, I like to explain to folks that in school counseling or in guidance, we have subject areas just like a math teacher does. A math teacher, you know, teaches algebra and geometry. We have three areas or three subjects too. We have social emotional development that we help kids with, their academic development, and their career development. And so when we're thinking about choices that we're helping kids make, we're helping kids make sound choices in all three of those subjects or all three of those areas. So, and then I'd like to just go through a couple of these things, just like I did with you just now. If I'm in an elementary school, I'm just going to focus on the elementary ones. If I'm in a high school, I would just focus on the high school ones. But I'm not spending a lot of time on this slide, but I'm wanting the council to kind of get used to what a goal looks like. Then, in terms of writing a goal, here I'm getting more concrete. I'm explaining to the council that when we write a goal in this initiative, every goal is going to start with to increase the percentage of, and then we're going to come up with a student group. If for many of them, it will be all students, but the student group might just be boys or it might be third graders. And then there's going to be a verb. So it's the percentage of all students who, and then a verb, report bullying, use healthy methods to de-stress. You know, so it's always going to be a student group and a verb, and then the choice that we want the kids to make. There'll be three parts of our goals. Okay, so then we want to emphasize that it doesn't have to be all kids. They can, you know, when you look at your data and you start talking about your kids, you may decide, you know, we don't want all kids to enroll in algebra. We just really want the eighth graders to do that when they enroll when they're enrolling for their ninth grade classes. So, you know, it wouldn't make sense to have this one be all students. Or it might be just, you know, we want eighth graders to enroll in electives related to the career interests. Or maybe we're just focusing on third graders reporting bullying or, you know, whatever. So it could be one grade level as a student group. It might also be a gender or, you know, it might be as you've looked at your disaggregated data that you discover it's not all students that are having a problem with this choice. It's just the boys aren't making this choice for some reason. So you can narrow down that student group any way you want to. Okay, so that's that. And then another idea, a lot of you are from small districts where there's maybe one or two elementary schools, a middle school, and a high school, or even in a large district, but this is especially easy to do in a smaller district. I think it's really nice to kind of get together with all the counselors across the district and to talk about how the goals can be sequential. For example, when I was working in a high school, there are some choices that it really would have been nice if kids had made in middle school before they got to me, so that when they hit the high school, I could just take them and run. So for example, it would have been really nice if before the kids got to me in high school, if maybe in seventh grade, they had identified a career cluster of interest, and in eighth grade, they had decided to enroll in electives that were related to their career cluster. So in my own district, when we met with all of our counselors, I said that to our middle school counselors, and they said, yeah, we can do that. So we started to, you know, really talk about how can we build the program sequentially, starting with kindergarten and then going up through through 12th grade. So if you're interested in coordinating a K-12 school counseling program this way, this would be a really good opportunity to do that, to just sit down and think about what choices would you like kids to have had made before they get to you, and then just communicate that to the counselor at the you know, the sending school. So, okay, something to think about with that slide. Okay, so now when we get to prioritizing our goals, we'll start with what we just call program goals or just goals. And those are all of the choices that we want kids to make. Choices that kids are already making, choices that maybe they're not making yet, just all of the choices that successful kids tend to make, we'll define that and we'll call them goals. And there will be a ton of them because successful kids make a lot of good choices. Then we'll take that list and then we'll say, okay, which of these choices are we already helping kids make? So you may find that in your school counseling program right now, you know, 80% of the choices that we want kids to make, you already have programming that is helping kids make those choices. So anything that you're already addressing, we're calling a priority goal, because we're assuming that because you're spending time and energy on it, it is a priority for you. So anything that you're already working on, we're calling a priority goal. And then we'll go a step below that to focus goals, and that's really what it's all about. We're saying, in a focus goal, we're saying, what small number of goals do we really want to hit hard next year so that every single student in the building is making that choice? And it would be perfectly okay to have just one goal that you're going to spend all that emphasis and time on. So it may be that you decide that, you know, homework, submitting homework is the one number one choice you want kids to make, and that's the only thing you're going to work on really, really hard. You'll still do all your other priority goals, but you're really going to focus on that one focus goal. So most of our schools, you know, will have a huge number of choices that they want all kids to make. They'll have a smaller number of things that they're already helping kids with, and then they'll have one, two, three, you know, a very small number of focus goals that they're really going to hit hard in the coming year. So I'm going to pause here real quickly. This is really key that you understand the three different levels of goals, and when I'm using the words priority goal and focus goal, you know what that means. So, you know, just wait real quickly. I see one question has been typed in here. Let me go back to that. So the question is coming from Natalie, and she's saying, I'm just going to read it out loud here. When will we get our survey data to use for goals? The survey data is there. As soon as you've surveyed 10 students, it's there. So it's there right now. She's saying that the meeting is next week. And it says that, they've got a needs revision. Okay. Yeah, Natalie, I hope I answered that question as she was talking about snow days. So, yes, that survey data is there. And I would just let Tina know that you've surveyed the 145 students, and which per grade level, I think you have four grade levels, so I think that should probably be fine if they split evenly. And Tina, at this point, we had a staff discussion about that a couple days ago. At this point, she's going to give you a meets criterion C comments, and then we'll just say, we understand, you know, please think about getting up as close to 95% as you can. So that should be okay. But the data, the results are always there as soon as you've surveyed 10 kids. So you should be able to see that data. So, okay, not seeing any other questions, and good. So I'm going to assume that this prioritization of the goals makes sense. Okay, so in terms of how many program goals, in our work, when we've come up with our list of suggested goals, these are the numbers that we've come up with. We think high school students, kids that are successful, tend to make about 67 good choices. There are 67 choices that we'd like high school kids to make, that I'd like my own children to make. We think there's about 50 choices and for middle school kids and 29 for elementary. So these numbers align with the number of suggested program goals that we have for your council to look at. These also align with the questions in the survey. So for all of our suggested program goals, you have baseline data for every one of those suggested program goals from the survey. It's all coordinated together. So, and again, sometimes when people see the 67, they just like freak out and they say, you know, why so many? And it's because, you know, we want to recognize that kids who are successful make a lot of good choices. That does not mean you're going to work on 67. It, you know, we're only going to work on one, two, or three at a time. But we want to recognize that there's, you know, there's a whole lot of other choices that are begging for our help with, you know, for us to help kids make. But given the time constraints, we realize that there's only, you know, just one, two, or three that we can do at a time. So, okay. Okay. So, this is some pushback that you might get. We've had schools tell us about this, and we've experienced it when we've been presenting this as well. Sometimes schools will say to us, you know, it's really unfair to help to expect the low-income students, for example, to make all these sound choices because they haven't had the opportunities that more affluent kids have had. And we think this is a really good place to start talking about some cultural change. If we lower our expectations of kids who don't have opportunities, they'll never get beyond our expectations. So we would like to suggest that we keep our expectations really high, and then we do whatever it takes as adults to help kids get up to our expectations. So, yes, it might be difficult for low-income kids to make choices to visit college campuses or to take an AP class where there's a fee, you know, for kids who are, there's a subsidy to help kids with testing in AP courses if you're very poor, but there's a lot of kids that are middle of the line that can't afford that test, that can't take it. So at any rate, this is a really good place to just kind of have the discussion of if this comes up about, you know, how can we expect all of our kids to make these choices when we don't give them the opportunities to do that? And we just wanted you to think about ahead of time, you know, do you want to lower your expectations so that we're going to say, well, you know, low-income kids, no, we're not going to expect them to do a campus visit. Or low-income kids, no, we're not going to expect them to take an AP class because they can't afford the test. Or are we going to think about what we need to do differently as adults to enable all kids to make those choices? So just something to think about. And you may want to take this slide out. You may want to reword it. There's a lot of words on this slide. But this is something that could come up. We hear it often in discussions and councils about how it's not fair to ask students to make choices when we don't give them the opportunities to make those choices. And we always come back and say, let's expect kids to make those choices and let's give them the opportunities. You know, so anyway, something to think about. We just wanted to make you aware that this could come up in your meeting. And so, and again, take the slide out, edit it, you know, just kind of think about this. Okay. The other point that we think might be good to kind of introduce is that it's not just the school counseling program that can help kids make good choices. You know, it could be the Kiwanis Club is going to tackle some of these goals, or the Boy Scouts are going to tackle some of these goals. So we hope that just in the discussion that other groups start to see, well, we could help too. And again, going back to the previous slide, if we're going to help all kids make these choices, and you know, the schools can't provide all kids with the opportunities they need right now, well, who can? And maybe there's somebody on your council that, you know, is willing to step up. We see that often. And, you know, would say, well, you know, we could take kids on campus visits or, you know, whatever. So something to think about, that it doesn't just have to be the counselors that are providing opportunities for kids. So, okay. So now, in the next part, so that's the introduction. In the next part, we are going to then work to help the council is going to work to help you identify what the student choices are that you want kids to make. So we're looking at, first of all, coming up with your big program goals, all the choices that you want your kids to make. So the first thing we're going to do is help kids to, or not help kids, we want to give your council just a chance to revisit the vision statement and especially that third paragraph. You know, let's think about what we want our ideal students to be like and what kind of choices does that mean that they're going to have to make. So again, we're wanting to attach goals to the vision. You know, the goals are a spin-off of the vision. The vision tells us what we want kids to be like. And now we're talking about, okay, what goals do we need in order to make kids like that? Okay, so then we're coming back and we're saying, We're asking people, you know, when you did the pre-meeting task, or you did this pre-meeting task, and then most of them will have checked a whole lot, if not all, of the suggested goals. So now we just want them to kind of go back and now look for the ones that they did not check and circle those. And there'll be a very small number. There may be none, maybe one or two. I doubt if there will be a lot. I've never ever heard of that situation, but theoretically there could be, but it's probably going to be a small number. And then we want to give them a chance to think about and just jot down a note. Were there any choices that you felt were missing from the list that we gave you? And chances are, you know, usually your councils will come up with, you know, two or three choices that, you know, our organization didn't think of, or that are maybe specific to your community, something that's important to you. Maybe there's a specific program that you offer, and the council is saying, you know, we want all students to choose to enroll in that program in your community. So they would just jot down what's missing, you know, from this list. Okay, so that's individual. Everybody's kind of doing that with the homework that they brought. If somebody hasn't done their homework, they can just quickly skim through that list and circle any that they don't think apply to your students. Okay, and then we're saying, let's go to small groups. And so now we're in groups of three or four people. And in their small group, they're just talking about, you know, what choices are not important for kids in our school to make. They don't apply to our kids. And are there any that need to be added? So everybody gets to talk about that a little bit in their small group. And hopefully everybody's talking because the groups are small. And then we're coming to large group. And we're saying, we're first of all asking everybody to all the small groups to share what choices need to be added, what was missing for our school. And then I've got a note on here to you, because this is really important that you add whatever they report out. Someone on your steering team has to write on the bottom of a tool that I'm about to show you that's called an Instagraph. We want to make sure that when we go to consensus building that these new ideas are going to be considered. Okay, so on the Instagraphs will be up on the wall. I'm going to go ahead one. And they look like this. So this is we give it to you as an 8.5 by 11, but you guys can, you know, blow it up to poster size. And it has all of the possible goals on the left. And then if it's a current goal for you, there's just a column where you can kind of check that to just kind of remind you this is something you're currently working on. And then what happens is the instructions are, you'll tell the council members to place sticky dots next to the choices that they feel, each person individually, that they feel that they do not feel are important for students at your school to make, so they don't apply to your kids. Okay, so, and then you've given, like when we do this, we get sticky dots at Staples and we cut them in the strips and we give everybody like 5 or 6 sticky dots. And they bring, or they, you can just give them a marker. They can also just take a marker and make an X or make a dot. And so then when I'm facilitating this, I'll usually say, okay, let's take a break. But during the break, come up to this poster and put your sticky dots on for the choices that you do that you feel are not important for the kids in your school, in our school. So the first person comes up, and usually we'll have a steering team member standing there to kind of make sure when they get up to the poster, they know what to do. First person comes up, they've got their sticky dots, and they say, okay, I don't think it's important for students to make choice number 2, plan to attend post-secondary education as a full-time student. This is not important to our kids. And so they put their little sticky dot in this first box. And then they also don't think that number 5 is important, or number 8 or 9 is important. I guess that's 8. So they put their sticky dots up. Then they go off and have their break. Next person comes up, and they also don't think that goal number 2 is important for your kids. So they put their little sticky dot to the right of the next of the one before it, and then you can see what's happened. Then third person comes up, they put their sticky dots up, the next person, And so what we're building here is a bar graph. And when everybody's finished, it makes the consensus building really easy. Nobody said that number one should be left out. So we know we don't even need to talk about number one. It's in. Nobody talked about number four. Almost everybody, you know, when you get it up here, you can say, well, you know, almost everybody thought that number two does not apply to our kids. Let's leave that out. And so really the only ones we need to talk about on this whole sheet are maybe number one and number seven, because, you know, one person thought that should be left out. And then maybe we need to talk about the two that had two votes. You know, to kind of see where does the, you know, how does the group feel about that? Does this need to come out or be in? So it's just a really good way to take a large group. So if you've got 25, 30 people on your council, it's just a really easy way to narrow down the conversation from the get-go, and then just talk about the things that are kind of in the middle. So that's an Instagraph. We actually are going to use Instagraph a lot in this process from this point on. We're going to use another one today. But it's just, we love them. It gets everybody out of their seats, and I like to use brightly colored sticky dots, and it's just kind of fun. They, you know, it's kind of like magic to see these bar graphs appear, and they can it's really easy for them, too, to see where the consensus comes from. And, you know, if I'm the person that put this yellow dot up on, you know, I understand now why I'm not, you know, I'm probably, you know, going to be asked to let that go, because I'm the only one who feels that way. So, but then on the other hand, I have a chance to say, no, I think I'd like to have a chance to convince the rest of you that we should leave that out. So, it's just a consensus building tool. Okay. So then when we have that list of goals, then we say, okay, can we live with these goals and can we support them publicly? And usually everybody says yes. Usually there's very few that they want to leave off of the list that we provide. And there's, you know, oh, also the ones that they added previously, the new ones, this is where you will have written them on the bottom of this Instagraph so that they could vote for those as well, that they should leave those off. Okay, so that's that. So now we need to start prioritizing. So on this part of the discussion, we're saying which goals, this is just kind of an open discussion, we're saying which goals are we already addressing in our school and community? Now, I would suggest as a counselor that you hold back on this discussion for right now, because there's probably going to be like 80% of those goals that you're already addressing, but we want to hear what other folks have to say first. So the tool we give you is a poster that looks like this, and it might be that someone says, you know, goal number two, explore college campuses, kids choose to do that. You know, I'm in the Kiwanis Club, and we take kids on a field trip to go see campuses. So you would write down, that's already being addressed, and it's the Kiwanis Club that's doing that, and here's what they're doing. It might be that, you know, one of the churches says, gosh, we take kids to this Christian conference, and, you know, it's on a college campus. So we talk about going to college when we do that. So we're kind of looking, you know, it's almost like curriculum mapping. We're kind of looking at what's already happening. It might be that a teacher in your school says, like the family and consumer science teachers, they teach a lot of career development. So they might bring that up. Or the health teachers might talk about how they teach social emotional content in their health curriculum. Or in the elementary schools, there's a lot of social emotional development all the way through by the classroom teachers. So we're kind of talking about what everybody's doing. And then at the end of this discussion, you as the counselors, you can say, gosh, when we look over this list, we're probably hitting 80% of those goals already. And, you know, we're not going to take the time to really talk about that right now, but we'll do that between this meeting and the next meeting, and we'll bring that back to you. So on the other hand, if you've got tons of time, you know, certainly bring up all the things that you do now. But I think it's more important here to hear what others are doing. So, okay, so that's what you're doing to identify the priority goals. Any goal that somebody is already addressing, it means somebody thought it was important. They gave it priority, and that's in there. Okay, so now we're moving on to the focus goals. And this is, I would suggest that you spend like half of your meeting on this section. This is really a rich discussion. So basically, the question is first, how many goals do we have the capacity to tackle in a big way? And, you know, as a counselor, you're probably thinking, you know, my plate is already full. I don't have any time to tackle any goals in a big way next year. And really, realistically, in most schools, that's probably the situation. So what we want to do here is we want to explain to the council why you're so busy and why you can't tackle more goals. And at this point, the council, you know, this is their third meeting. They're into being there for the kids. And all of a sudden, you're telling them, and there's been some trust built between them and you. And they realize when you say, I don't have enough time, I don't have enough money, you're not just whining. You know, you care about the kids. And so we're going to go into problem-solving mode here. So on this slide, you're able to say, you know, let's just look at the realities of this. And then let's think about if, you know, if some of this could change, then I could hit a lot of focus goals, you know, maybe two or three. But if nothing changes, you know, I can't hit any focus goals, or maybe I could hit one, you know. So we're going to look at a counselor's capacity limiters. And we're going to give the council data so that it's not just you know, it doesn't appear like the counselor is just standing up and whining about how busy they are, that this really is the situation, and we can prove that now because you've been collecting this data all year. So, okay, so the first thing is just looking at personnel. So we are looking at, you know, in this slide, you've written down all of your counselors' names. You've written down what their FTE is. So they're a full-time counselor would get a 1, a half-time counselor would get a 0.5. So we're looking at, you know, what their full-time equivalency is. And then we're looking at the percentage of time that counselor spends performing things that are not school counseling. So this is one of the reasons why we've been keeping that time task log, because you're going to be able to go to that log now and you're going to be able to say, Jane Doe is spending 50% of her time doing things that have nothing to do with counseling. You know, John is spending, you know, 25% of his time, whatever. And what that means is that we don't really have a full-time counselor. We have a three-fourths time counselor or a two-thirds time counselor. So I just actually was looking at data earlier today for a large school. They have 10 counselors. And on paper, they think they have 10 counselors, but when you add up all the non-program time together, they really only have 8 counselors in the building. And they have the equivalent of two, you know, all the hours added up that they do non-counseling tasks was the equivalent of 2 full-time positions. So, you know, that was fascinating. And now the community is kind of saying, let's make some changes here. So this is really, you know, we're just tossing it out there. We're not complaining. We're not saying that, you know, these tasks aren't important. We're just acknowledging that we can't do focus goals if we're spending time on non-program tasks. And then later, when we're in a few slides from now, we're going to work on a resource expansion plan. And it may be that folks say, you know, well, what are those non-program tasks that you do? And let's look for somebody else to do them. And which happens in a lot of schools. So, okay. So we're also looking at the student to counselor ratio, except this time, instead of saying we have 400 to 1, if you've got on paper a full-time counselor, 400 to 1, we're going to adjust this ratio so that it's 400 to 0.75. And then we'll do the math so that, you know, you'll do the math so it's, I don't know what that would end up being. It would be, instead of 1 to 400, it might be 1 to 475 or whatever after you do the ratio on there. So if when you calculate the adjusted FTE, if you're not full time, that means that you actually have, you know, more students for a full-time counselor than, you know, than you appear to on paper. So, and again, in our online system, this is all calculated for you. In the online system, it will tell you your adjusted FTE. That is calculated at, from all the data that you put in the time task logs. So, okay, this is a really powerful discussion that gives you an opportunity to get rid of a lot of the non-program tasks. Okay, then we want to look at, you know, in terms of personnel, do you have a support staff? We've had many, many schools that after the council and the administration, everybody looks at this and they think about, gosh, our counselors could really, you know, tackle, you know, some of those focus goals if we have support staff for them. Let's hire a secretary. We've had schools where, like a Kiwanis Club has stepped up and said, you know, well, how much would a secretary cost? And let's do some fundraising. And, the you know, somebody outside the school does fundraising to provide a support staff. In my own school, our community members said, how can we be your support staff? And they came in and started volunteering in our office to do some of the, you know, just the non-program stuff that we were doing. So, okay. I also had some teachers step up to say, how could I help you in my prep? So you just don't, you know, you just never know until you put it out there. But at this point in time, there's a sense of urgency because they want those focus goals. And now you're saying, but there's a problem. We don't have time or resources. And then everybody starts, you know, just problem solving. Okay. So another possible limiter is how the counselors actually use their time. And this is, again, we're kind of getting at the non-program tasks. So in this part of the activity, this is one of my favorite things in all of our work. You'll ask the council to just jot down on a piece of scrap paper in front of them, turn over their notes or whatever, turn over their agenda, and just jot down, what percentage of time would you like our counselors ideally to spend in each types of these activities? And usually they'll write down a very small number on non-program. They'll put maybe 10% in management. They'll put higher percentages in guidance and counseling. And you're just asking them to do that as an individual activity, so no talking, just you know, quick brainstorm, what do you think? Then, this is the coolest activity. You have five of these Instagraphs up on the wall, and you say to folks, okay, everybody, let's get up, go to one of the posters, and whatever it says on the top, if it says guidance, look at what you wrote down on your notes. If you said, you know, 40% of the counselor's time should be spent on guidance, this time you're going to find the 40%, go one box above it, and put your sticky dot there. And then, you know, whatever. And then they'll go to the next the poster, go to the counseling poster, find the percentage, put your sticky dot there. What happens, it's the coolest thing. I love this activity. It's like magic. These little normal curves, bell graphs, appear on each of the posters. And at the top of the bell curve, if you take that percentage and you add them together for all the posters, they'll come out at 100%. And you'll have consensus immediately about how counselors should be spending their time. It's really kind of a fun activity. Depending on how you average, you may end up with 101% or 99%. So you might need to kind of tweak just a little bit. But yeah, it's really kind of a cool activity. Once in a while, we have people that get two bell curves and, you know, there's two humps to their curve for some reason. And then they'll just go in between the two humps and, you know, put the percentage there. But it's really kind of a fun activity. And it's real clear to everybody, you know, what the consensus is. So now you've got the ideal in terms of how they want you to spend your time. Now you can come back with reality and say, okay, this is wonderful. You know, this is really cool. Here's your desired time. And so very quickly you type that in here, what they just came up with. And now here's our actual. And, you know, we'll start to see where, how they want you to spend your time and how you're actually spending your time, maybe two different things. In my own program, you know, I was really, really heavy on non-program and my counsel didn't want me spending any time on non-program. And I was also heavy on counseling because I like it. And so it was just based on what I like to do. And my counselor was saying, no, our kids need guidance. And so we had to make some adjustments in that. But this is, again, it's a really kind of powerful activity in terms of designing your program. Other limiters might be funding. On this screen, we're just explaining to people that you have, when I was at DOE, we did a quick study. I think the average per pupil expenditure for guidance was like 42 cents per student. And again, this may be where, you know, a community organization who's on your council steps up and says, well, we could donate, you know, $200. That'd be nothing to us. And, you know, for you, that would like double your whole budget. So just acknowledging, you know, this is the money we have. And then another limiter could be professional development. I know in my own practice, some of our goals, I didn't know how to help students with those goals, some of our social and emotional goals. So I needed professional development in order to be able to do that. And so in this chart, you would edit this list, you know, take off or add to it or whatever, and you're just identifying which activities your counselors are participating in. And again, when I was at DOE, we did a study of this, and something like 80% of the counselors in Indiana did no professional development. And if that's the case in your building, you know, then you know, the question is, how do our counselors stay up to date? You know, they don't get textbooks like a math teacher does with all the most current worst stuff in it. So it's really, you know, important for counselors to get out of the building and go to professional development activities or take a class or, you know, read journals or whatever. So again, this could be a limiter to your ability to take on the focus goals. So, okay. So after you've presented that to everybody, and you're really going to have to move fast through that, then we're coming up with a capacity expansion plan. So we're just saying to folks, you know, which one of these limiters do we want to focus on? And my guess is they'll probably say time use. And then you'll just brainstorm, you know, how can we get the counselors more time? How can we, you know, take away those non-program tasks? Or, you know, you might say for us it's funding. And then, you know, how can we get the counselors more money? Or usually it's not personnel, because, you know, most that hiring another counselor is really expensive, and that's, you know, a limiter that sometimes people can't see a way past. But other times people say, we need another counselor to figure it out. So anyway, so we'll have a capacity expansion plan, and then we'll look at how many focus goals do we think we can handle. So they'll say, you know, given our expansion plan, and that we're going to take all the non-program tasks away from the counselor. We think the counselor says, you know, given that change, I could do maybe two focus goals and really hit it hard with every kid. You know, we could develop the curriculum and the one-on-ones that we need with kids or whatever. So, okay. So so you're identifying what your focus goals are, and you know, you go to the list and pick out the two or three things that you really think are important. And then you're coming back and doing one last capacity check. And we put this slide in specifically for counselors who may be feeling overwhelmed, that, you know, if your council says, oh, yeah, we want you to do 12 focus goals next year, and, you know, we're going to have baseline data and follow-up data, and our expectation is that you'll have every kid making that choice, and there's 12 of those choices that they have to make, and you're thinking, oh, my gosh, there's no way. This is your chance to just stop everybody and say, wait a minute, there's no way, you know, you've got me way over capacity. And if you have 12 focus goals, what's going to happen is you're going to get every one of them in a mediocre way, because I'll be spread so thin, you know, we won't be able to do that. And, or, you know, we don't have the resources that we need to do this. We don't have a teacher advisor program where we could teach some of this. We don't have, you know, a support helper. So this is the counselor's chance to say, wait, stop. You know, this is not going to work. So if that's the case, then the council has to go back and say, you know, okay, we're going to omit our focus goals, or we're going to omit some of the priority goals, take away some of the stuff that you're already doing that's maybe less important, and then go to a focus goal that you're going to help all kids with. So yeah, so this is just kind of the capacity check. Okay. So then the final slide is you're just telling, you know, thanking folks for coming and just giving them a heads up, because we don't want them to be surprised later, that the steering team after the meeting, you're going to have a do some thinking about, are there any required goals that you have to do because somebody outside your department said you have to do them. For example, DOE, Indiana DOE, says that you have to do a bullying prevention program. Are you drop, has your, you know, principal said you're going to drop that into the school counseling program? You know, has your central office said that, you know, all of our middle schools are going to work on career clusters? So are you getting directives from somewhere outside of the council that would lead people to, that would force you to have to put a goal in? So these are kind of like compliance goals or things that your council didn't come up with, but you have to be compliant to keep your boss happy or the state happy or whatever. Okay. Then you're just giving your council heads up that the steering team is going to create knowledge statements for each of the priority goals, and that you're just going to start defining what do kids need to know in order to make the choices that they've come up with. Those are your knowledge statements, and this will spin off into a guidance curriculum later. We're not going to do that in this step. That will happen next month. You're going to review student data to see if our goals make sense. You know, maybe they have a goal and you look at the student data and the kids are already making that choice. So it's really maybe not the best goal for you. Maybe there's, you know, some other choice that kids aren't making that we need to look at. And then finally, the steering team is going to add baseline data and target data for each of the focus goals. So this will only happen, the data is only going to happen for the two or three goals that you're focusing on, not for all of the 68 goals. So we're just giving the council a heads up that there's some stuff that your steering team is going to do after this meeting that you'll come back to them with. And then finally, you know, the dates of your future meetings, and that's it. So I'm looking at time. I know that I'm going over a little bit. I'm thinking maybe 10 minutes. I just want to show you how to enter information into the computer, and I'm looking for questions real quickly, and I'm not seeing any questions. So I'm going to fly to the online system, and okay. So in terms of getting this into the computer, there's a couple of things. I'm going to scroll down to the goals section. We've tried to save you a lot of time in the way that we've set this up. It looks like there's a gazillion steps, but most of these steps are just like checklists. So everything we've talked about so far is up to here, conduct meeting three. Here's the memo that you're sending out. Here's meeting three. And then here's where you enter your program goals, and this is going to be very simple. So I'm going to click on this. And I get the school already has, our sample school already has some goals in. When you put a goal in, it's going to appear down here in this list. You're going up here, conduct your meeting, then you're going to add suggested program goals. So when I click on that, here are all of our suggested program goals. And all you have to do is click the ones that you like. You know, do you want to help kids make the choice? This is for our younger grades to do their best at school. If you're in a high school, this won't even appear on your list. You'll have the high school goals. But you're gonna say, you know, let's say you're in an elementary school and you want that one for your kindergartners. And then you're saying, do you want it for all grades or just selected grades? So I'm just going to focus on this with my kindergartners. I'm not going to hit this with all of my kids. So I'm going to put that as a kindergarten goal. And furthermore, I'm not going to hit it with all students. I just want to focus on the boys, which probably you would never do, but you have the ability to say, I want this goal just for a subgroup, if not for all kids. This is how you define your student group. You can say it's for a grade level, or you can narrow it down by the ethnicity or gender or economic level on who you're setting that goal for. You can also put in a goal twice. you can put in do your best at school and have that be for all kids if you want to track the data for all kids. But then let's say you want to track it for boys also, just because you're trying to close a guidance gap between, you know, the boys and girls and doing their best at school. So you could, you know, create this goal one time and have it be for all students, and then create it another time and have it be just for boys. So just something to think about. So that's how you get the goals in. And then let's say there's a goal that's not on our list. If I go back, for goals that are not on our list, it says add program goals that you create, and you click on enter, and a little pop-up comes up. You give the to impact the percentage of students who, you just put the student choice description in there, and then you tell us about the student group that you have that goal for. You click save the goal, and you're it's easy. You've got it done. Okay. Now, one really important thing. So to make sure you're hearing me say this, please. Any goal that you get from our suggested program goal list is going to already have baseline data associated with it. So if you can live with the way we've worded a goal, if you can, like, you know, if our goal is close to what you want to do, if you select our goal, we've got baseline data from the survey that's going to connect there for you, so you're not going to have to worry about data collection. And your follow-up data will also come from the survey, so you're not going to have to worry about data. You'll just give the survey, and that will be it. If you create your own goal, you're going to have to come up with your baseline data. You're going to have to have a way to figure that out, what percentage of kids are making that choice right now. And then you'll have to figure out a way to get your follow-up data, which a lot of schools do. So that's not a bad thing. And then if you don't like the way that one of our goals is worded, you don't have to use it, our wording, but you would have to create your own goal to get your own wording in there. We can't change the wording in the goal, because if we don't want to make the wording different than the survey, because then we're worried that the data might not actually express what the goal is saying. So there's just something to know there. And down here in this section, you can edit goals that you create, but you can't edit goals that you've taken from our list. Again, because we want to make sure that we have integrity of the data with that goal. So if you read this and you think that you don't like the way this wording is, you could just delete it and then create your own goal, but then you're going to have to come up with your own data. Which in some of these, you know, in this first one, are never sent to the office. I mean, that would be an easy one to get data for. You just go to whoever keeps the records in your office about, you know, discipline, and ask them, you know, how many kids have been sent to the office. So. Okay, so I wanted to talk about that. So that's in reading the goals. So we entered the program goals, and then we're going to add external program goals. We just put this in as a step to remind you to think about that. Actually, when you go to this enter button, it's the same one that we just looked at. But we just wanted to remind you that if there's, you know, somebody outside your department is saying you have to have this goal, we got to remember to put it in. So that's a reminder step. Then you're going to select your priority goals. So you're going to go there. And what will happen is these are just your goals. So everything that you didn't check in the previous step is not going to appear here. And you're just going to check the 1, 2, or 3 that you want to give priority to. So you can see in the school, in our demo school, they gave priority to 3 of their goals. So that means that 3 of these goals they're currently addressing. If they, you know, if they want to say, you know, we're addressing 80% of this, they just check more, and then they hit save, and now they have, you know, 8 priority goals or however many that was. Okay, so that's as simple as the priority goals is. I'm going to go back to, that was select priority goals. Then enter the priority goals knowledge statement. This takes a little bit of thought and more time. I would think about delegating tasks in your steering team for this in this month, and this may be something that gets delegated to someone else so that one person isn't doing all of this. But basically, any of your priority goals that we just checked will pop up here. And like the first one says, demonstrate ethical decision and social responsibility. So the first question says, do kids need to have specific knowledge in order to make this choice? And so that takes some thought. You know, do kids need to be knowledgeable? You'll come up with, yes, kids need to know why it's important to be socially responsible. So you're going to say yes, and then kids need to know why it's important, you know, to be socially responsible, and then you just hit that. This then, in a later month, this is going to become something that you think about, how are we going to teach kids that? So we're starting to build your guidance curriculum in this step. Okay, so I'm going to go back. That is the knowledge statement. And I would give some careful thought to this step because, again, your curriculum is going to be as strong as what your knowledge statements are. If you miss knowledge points that kids need to learn, you're going to miss curriculum. So it's okay on some of the choices, like for kids to choose to enroll in algebra, there's a lot of stuff they need to know. They need to know why it's important to take math, why they need to know how to enroll. Enrolling in AP, same thing. How do you enroll in AP or taking the FAFSA? There's a lot of steps, involved in that. So you may have 6 or 7 knowledge statements for one priority goal. We want to make sure that every bit of knowledge that kids need to know, you've identified. Okay, so in the next step, we're just going to say, okay, we're not going to work on everything. We're only going to work on 3 things in a big way. We are going to work on all the priority goals, but we're going to work on 3 in a major way. So I click on that. Now only the priority goals have popped up, and I've checked the 3 or 1 that I want to really, really hit hard, and I've hit save. Okay, then that's the focus goals. Okay, now at this point, we want to look at some student data. So the first thing we want to do, and this is a little bit technical, so I'll try to explain this very clearly, but we want to give you the opportunity to use data other than the data that we're providing. And that's what you're doing in this section. So you're going to click on this, and your goals will pop up. Your focus goals will pop up. And then the survey data will pop up as well. So this school's had 2 years of survey data. Your reports will look a little bit prettier than this. Demo school has 13 grade levels in it, which we don't have. None of your schools have 13 grade levels in it. So your charts will fit in this little box. But let's say that you're happy with this one. You're just going to use survey data with kids self-reporting that they were sent to the office or not. But let's say that you decide, you just want to talk to whoever does discipline in your office and see, what percentage of the kids have been sent to the office, in the past year. So you would click on select data source. And now you have a choice. You can say, I'm just going to use some other data source, or I want to use the survey and another data source. I'm going to click on survey and another data source. This is giving me a little warning. I'm going to say okay. And now when I go here, I can see that whole goal disappeared. And that's because it's up here in this tab now that says multiple sources. So when I go up here, I can see that I have a text box now that, you're going to type in what you counted. We counted the number of students who on the school's disciplinary report or whatever, and then click save. If you change your mind, you can, you know, go back and say, I want to use only the survey data, or I want to use only this data and forget the survey. And then also, we're going to ask you to put in the baseline data. If you're doing something other than the survey, when was that data collected? So that year. Or if you don't have any data for that goal, but you don't want to use our survey data, or it's a brand new question that you've added and there is no survey data for it, you just click, I don't have any data right now. So, okay, and then save. So the goals in their data will appear in one of these three tabs. If it's from multiple sources, it would appear here. If I say I only want to use this data source, now I'm only using the other source. Now I'm saying okay. And now that is going to disappear, and I've got it only, it's in the column now with current data only from the other source. Okay, so again, if you're using all survey data, this, you won't have to do any editing on this, but most of our schools have one or two goals that they want to look at some data other than survey data, so we wanted to give you an opportunity to do that. Okay. So we're editing the goal survey data, and now in this section, we want to think about, is there anything in our focus goals data that is making us think that this should not be a focus goal? Primarily, it might be if 100% of the kids are already making that choice, then why do you have it as a goal? Or maybe 90% of the kids are making that choice, but in this other really important area, that's not a focus goal, only 20% of the kids are making that choice, and now you're kind of rethinking, oh my gosh, maybe we should do that as a focus goal. So this, in this section, we're just giving you an opportunity to edit your focus goals after you've looked at your data. And then finally, after you're happy with all your focus goals, the very last thing you're doing is we're going to enter data targets. So in this section, your focus goals will pop up. So you can see there's only three of them here. And we're saying the first one is demonstrate ethical decision-making, social responsibility. And we already have a target in here that they've put in, that they want the target to be 50%. And actually, they created this last year. But I can, you know, when you put that in, you would put the date in that was, you know, of the year that you want it. Let me show you. So if I wanted a new target, I'm going to say, you know, maybe it was 50% by 2018 and you met that. So now I'm going to put, I want it to be 75% by December of 2021. So, and then you can put another data target if you want to go, you know, a year beyond that. So, you've got places where you can put data targets in, and then later a year from now, we'll look to see, you know, did you meet that target? So, okay. And then same thing if you've got the data targets from other sources, there are none in here, but it would tell you, you know, you're going to count your discipline referral report and you'll put in targets for that as well for any data fields that you've created. Okay. I go back. Changes have not been saved. Okay. And that's it. So the last step is getting those data targets in here. So there's quite a lot of work to do after your meeting, and that we just wanted to point that out to you. I know a lot of our schools, at this point, a lot of schools will do like a retreat from their counselors, and we'll take counselors from all the buildings. You know, if there's more than one building that's doing RSC or guiding all kids, you know, the counselors do a little retreat and they'll work on this step. Or the counselors will just, you know, sequester themselves for a half day and get all this work done. So we just want to give you a heads up that, you know, you are going to need some time before we move on to our next step, root causes. You're going to need some time to get the knowledge statements done and get the focus goals all done and the data targets defined and that kind of stuff, because we need that before we move on. So, okay, I think that's it. Tina is available. Tina has been through this a gazillion times. And I see we have another question. What's the best way to contact Tina? Really, either by phone or email. Her phone is 812-349-4142. So that's the same phone number as, you know, it's our general number, and then just ask for Tina and they'll transfer you to her. Or you can send her an email, which is just Weissman, or Weissman, Weissman, at, and then our email address, ASAinstitute.org. So, yeah, so just Weissman at ASAinstitute.org. I've been hearing good things about the help that she's been giving schools since we brought her in to work with RSC. And you know, you should be able to get a hold of her right away, or, you know, hear back from her within a few hours, or, you know, if she's out of the building working at a workshop with us, it might be next day. But typically it's like she's either on the phone or she'll get right back to you. So, and if that ever becomes a problem, let me know. You know, occasionally we get overwhelmed and then we have to kind of think about how we're assigning tasks and who can come in to help Tina. If it's especially busy time for her, I'll help with some of the reviews, or some of our other staff members will. So if things get bogged down, let us know, and we'll, but Tina will probably give me a heads up before you do, if that's the case, and then we'll jump in and help her. So I think that's it. I'm looking for any other questions coming in. I'm not seeing anything. I appreciate your patience with us going over a bit this time. There's just a lot to cover, and the next two meetings should not be like that. So, okay. Well, I guess we'll close and thank everybody very much for doing this, and keep your questions coming. Talk with Tina, and if for those of you who had the snow days, just send, like you're saying, for Natalie, just send her an email, explain the situation, and she's going to give you a meets criteria C comments, and we'll just make a comment in there that we understand why you couldn't meet the rubric item. So, okay, I think that's it. Thank you, everybody, and we will talk to you next month. Good luck to everyone. Bye-bye.